Hey, have you heard about the massive container ship that blocked one of the world's busiest shipping route, the Suez Canal? No? Look at this.
This is a heck of a situation. Nobody thought it could happen. It did.
One of the world's most important shipping routes is jammed.
A team of tugboats was put to work on the stricken container ship today.
Samudra ka traffic jam aaj aapko dikhane wale hain. Hum aapko
dozen ships away. The Suez Canal.
It took 10 years to construct it with slavery of over 1.5 million laborers, and it took only one day, one giant ship, for it to get blocked. The echoes of clogging heard throughout the world, or perhaps the most important 193 km of water on the planet. So let's first talk about its geography and see why this little canal is so important. Look at this map beside Egypt. That narrow path you see, yes, that is Suez Canal. As you can see, it connects the North Atlantic and Northern Indian Ocean through the Mediterranean and the Red Sea. The passage allowed direct waterway travel between Europe and Asia, in absence of which ships would have needed to go all the way around Africa. How much longer is that route? Around 8,900 kilometers more. That is almost 8 to 10 days worth of travel for shipping containers. But how did 220,000-ton, 400-meter-long megaship get stuck in between the canal, halting economic activity throughout the world? According to a statement released by the ship's manager, an Egyptian official, the vessel grounded because of strong winds with gusts up to 30 miles per hour, not because of mechanical or engine failure. The heavy winds of sandstorm pushed the cargo of more than 20,000 shipping containers sideways. That's some serious shit. It has led to the ship, the Ever Given, to become stuck between the two banks of the canal. The traffic jam of cargo ships created by this blockage and the 1300-foot ship stuck between are even visible from the space. The effort to refloat the stuck ship haven't been successful so far. This has resulted in immense loss for the global trade. Data provided by Refinitiv estimates that there are at least 100 ships stranded on both sides of the waterway, of which 46 are container vessels and 47 are bulk carriers. As 8 large tugboats strain against the mammoth ship in attempt to push and drag the ship while dredgers work to clear sand and mud. The company working on the operation warned that the process could take days or even weeks. It is no surprise that refloating a ship taller than even Empire State Building is proving to be a challenge. Let's talk about the business impact if it is closed more than 15 days. The Suez Canal handles about 10% of all global trade, as it offers a shortcut worth about 10 days sailing time for ships going from Asia to Europe and beyond. Around 30% of world's container traffic uses the canal, and more than 50 ships pass through it on average day. According to London-based Lloyd's List, a shipping news journal, daily westbound traffic on the Suez Canal is worth around 5.1 billion, while the eastbound traffic is worth 4.5 billion. That means that the single ship getting stuck is costing the world $9.6 billion per day. You may be surprised to know, but there are virtually no alternatives like rail or roads when it comes to shipping goods from Asia to Europe. So, the blockage will definitely delay a range of goods and materials, like cotton coming to Europe from India, or petroleum coming from the Middle East, or plastic and auto parts from China. The impact on countries like USA and Canada would be less direct, as they receive most of their shipments from Asia from West Coast. However, products that are assembled in Europe and then shipped to US may see delay. Also, the blockage will prevent the empty shipping containers from returning to Asia on time, adding to the already existing container shortage caused by the rising demand for consumer goods after the pandemic. According to the Lloyd's Canal facilitates transport of about 1.9 million barrels of oil a day. That's around 7% of all seaborne oil. Countries like Spain, Italy, and France, who rely on oil shipment through the canal, could see higher gas prices, but we are not talking about sky-high shooting of prices, we are talking cents on the barrel. According to Jim Burkhardt, head of crude oil research at IHS Market, the impact on the global oil market will be limited as the energy demand is still weak due to the pandemic. And the Suez pipeline has unused capacity to move oil around the canal from one end near Alexandria, Egypt to a terminal near the Red Sea. Mark Jain, the chief economist at Moody's Analytics, also feels that the canal blockage likely won't have much impact on the global economies unless it drags on for the months. Even if it did last for months, there are other options. They will of course add cost, but they will not halt the economy. But if it is cleared in the next week, it won't even be remembered as a footnote in history of the oil market. Now let's talk about how was it made. It was built using a combination of slave labor and new industrious machinery. Beginning in the late 1860s, and thousands of peasants were forced to work with nominal pay under the threat of violence. These laborers used picks and shovels to dig the early portion of the canal by hand, which of course was a slow process. The project got into trouble after the use of forced labor was banned in 1863, after which hundreds custom-made steel and coal-powered shovels and dredges were used to dig the canal, increase the speed of project. Out of the 75 million cubic meters of sand that was dug out during the canal, around 3/4 was dug out by machinery. And that's how the Suez Canal was made. It remained a narrow and shallow canal, unable to accommodate even two-way traffic from modern ships for years. Until in 2014, Egypt's Suez Canal Authority announced the plan to deepen the canal and create a new 20-mile lane branching off the main channel. The expansion opened in 2015, but apparently it wasn't enough to prevent a 1300-foot megaship from getting stuck in between the canal, blocking more than 100 ships at each side and disrupting global economy in the way that reminds me of simpler time. Humans haven't really gotten that far. When you think about it, the generation to come may even laugh at some of the things that disturbed our life even today in 2021. Now let's talk about the history about the canal. But this is not the first time crisis the canal had to endure. During June 1967, a six-day war between Egypt and Israel broke out. The canal was shut down and locked by the Egyptian government from both sides, with mines and cluttered ships. But 15 international ships were still inside the canal at its midpoint when it got closed, and they would remain stranded there for 8 years. Yes, 8 years. Most of the crew members were rotated on and off the stranded vessels on the 3-month assignments. The rest of them, they passed the time by forming their own floating community and hosting events and sports. As the years passed, the fleet even developed its own stamps and internal system of trade. The ships were finally allowed to leave canal in 1975. By that time, only 2 of 15 vessels could make the voyage with their own power. Others had to be pulled by bigger ships. But why hasn't anyone made a movie on this yet? I mean, they should make. Now let's talk about what are the steps being taken to solve the problem. The vessels that are stuck now must decide if they want to wait it out or take the longer route around the Southern Africa, which can add week in sailing time and carry within an additional security risk, as Africa's eastern coast has had a long history of piracy. Heavy equipment is being used day and night to free the megaship with no luck so far. Excavators are scooping sand away from both sides with an estimated 19,600 to 26,000 cubic yard sand to shift, in hopes that with the help of high tides, the tugboat might be able to refloat the vessel. Some experts are also saying that the best chance to unstuck the ship would come either this Sunday or Monday, when tide will be higher. If that doesn't work, its fuel may be drained to make it lighter. It also has been some discussions about trying to pull on both ends of the ship with cable fixed to heavy machines on land. But with this option, there is a very real risk of damaging the ship. Well, just another day, just another headache for the global economy, already strained by more than a year-long pandemic. That's all for the today. If you like the video, please share and subscribe. And if you have any feedback, please let us know in the comment section below. Bye-bye, hasta la vista, tata.
घाट घाट पर चढ़ता जादू।